subscriber wrote in recently, and his name is Mr. Bachata Freak. Cool name. And he asks, can you make a video showing how you made this? I put, yeah, sure. What kind of things would you find useful in this video? And he replied, how you shot this? Was it handheld or with a gimbal? Maybe a step-by-step on how to physically record this. Also, how you color graded it. I would pay for this, no lie. I'm paying for college tuition. So I immediately sent him an invoice. He wired me the funds. And here we are. This was a video that I made as a bit of a, just something I wanted to do, basically just practicing cinematography like you do, or like you should be doing if you want to get better. I found the actor from a Facebook group. I'd always wanted to shoot in this location. It's in the near Lloyd's building in the city of London. Absolutely phenomenal architecture. We rolled up there. I had the ideas for the music already. I always have ideas for the exact music I'm going to use, because what I do is I'll put that music on my phone on a loudspeaker. When the actor model is moving around to the music, I'm kind of moving around and jigging around, even though, you know, white guys can't dance or whatever, but you know, I'm just moving around, following him and feeling what he's doing. And basically I'm just shooting on a standard rig. So just a cage with a handle, with a monitor on top, nothing fancy. I'm just holding the camera with IBIS on, obviously. And I've got my hand constantly on the lens to focus, because I'm using manual lenses, Zeiss contacts lenses. Or I've got my variable neutral density filter on the end, so I can control my exposure and my focus with just the one hand. The camera settings never change. I shoot everything at 24 frames a second in Vlog, set my white balance, use one of the native ISOs, so either 1600 or 4000. That's it, the camera settings don't change. There's some slow-mo in this video, so I shot that at 60 frames a second, but everything else remains the same. Don't get too hung up on millions of different camera settings within the camera. They're pretty much all irrelevant to getting a good image. You want the highest quality you can get from the camera, which is 10-bit color in 4K. At 24 frames a second, that's the best you're gonna get out of the sensor. So yeah, so I'm just moving around, kind of moving to the music and following and feeling what he's doing, racking focus constantly. There's gonna be loads of shots that are out of focus. I'll play you some clips from behind the scenes, ungraded clips, and you can hear me sort of chatting to the actor in the background, you know, come here, move there, whatever. There's loads of stuff that's out of focus, but I don't care, because there's gonna just be those nuggets where things are nicely in focus, or maybe it drifts out of focus, in focus. I quite like that. Somebody once described my work as rough around the edges, and I think that's what it is. But that's the reason people hire me to shoot stuff compared to other filmmakers that are in the area, because my stuff, I would say two things. One, it's very loose because of the handheld style that I like. The second thing is the way I grade stuff is quite dark, moody, gritty, filthy. I like lots of grain, whereas other people that live around here that do filming, their stuff's more corporate looking or clinically looking. You know, there's nothing wrong with that, but it's just not, I'm not really interested in that. I mostly work with actors, not corporate sit down interviews and stuff like that. Don't do that. Just keeping that flowy vibe is something you just have to practice. You just have to go out and shoot that way. If you're used to shooting everything on a manual focus, sorry, an autofocus camera, and not having to rack focus continually, then you're not going to have that muscle memory in your hand of sort of knowing how to do it on the fly without thinking about it. I've shot like that for years, so I don't know any other way. I have never shot with an autofocus camera. Even if I had the S5 II, I'd still be wanting to use my Zeiss contacts lenses, so the autofocus wouldn't do me any good anyway. So yeah, it's just something, a skill you develop. I've spoken about this plenty of times in other videos, so I don't want to try and repeat myself here and bore you to tears. I mean, like I say, the other thing that sort of goes into this, most of my style and my look, is the grade. So what we're going to do now is we'll jump on Premiere. I'll talk you through how I've graded this project. The way I grade projects is the same. The grade will be different, but the process is the same on every project, because there's certain things I've got in my mind about what I want to achieve. And there's a step-by-step kind of process in my brain of how we're going to get from the log image to the finished image. So we'll jump on Premiere now, and hopefully it'll be beneficial to Mr. Bachata. Sorry, I forgot your name. You know, I've seen some real wacky ways that people color grade stuff on YouTube tutorials, and I always find it a bit bizarre, really, because I just work very simply. There's nothing super complicated about what I do. I don't even bother using DaVinci Studio, because way too much for what I need. I'm not color grading some kind of epic masterpiece, you know. You can get good results right in Lumetri. Anyway, waffling aside, let's jump into it. So I've got this frame here. This is log, obviously. We are going to browse to the LUTs, and we're going to stick the standard Panasonic LUT on the footage. You can see the exposure's decent. It's just nicely in the middle there. And I'm generally going to be grading the image down, i.e. I'm going to be bringing the waveform lower down and darkening it. Yeah, making it more moody. So let's start doing that. First thing I'm going to do is I am going to put a film stock on it, because that's just going to help straight away with contrast levels. That is a Fuji 3510, and that's just instantly giving the image more punch. I'm going to leave it at 100% as well. And then I'm just going to go into basic correction. I'm going to add more contrast, and then I'm going to bring the black point down. And then I'm gonna bring the shadows down to, looks okay to me. Then the next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna sharpen the image. Usually 30 is a good point for me to go with. And then I'm just gonna add a touch of faded film just to bring some information back into those shadows. Whether this is technically correct according to a proper color grading studio, I guarantee it's not, but I don't care. I'm just gonna do what I do, and if it looks good, it looks good. I mean, a lot of the times I would be using curves in here to pick out certain colors, but in this particular image, there is really no messing around with different hues and stuff that I want to do with this image. Like, I'm a big fan of the hue saturation curve, and I'm a big fan of the hue versus hue curve if you need to change the color of something. On this particular image, I'm going for quite a, what's the word, analogous, where all the colors are very similar, basically, and which is going to be on the greeny side of things. So I'm not really going to use that. Point to take away from this is I don't use tools that I don't need to use. I don't be faffing around adding loads of tools in there just for the sake of it, because they're there, because that's kind of pointless. So I'm going to be dragging this shadows into the sort of greeny bluey area. I'm going to be doing a similar thing with the highlights, because like I say, we're going for analogous type image. And then because the skin tones have gone off towards green as well, I'm going to combat that by pushing them over towards yellow. And I think that gets us somewhere close to this is a finished still down here from the finished video. So let's have a look at that. So that was the finished project that you've seen that I showed at the very beginning of this video. I shot this video ages ago, so I can't even remember what I did, but that looks very similar there. The only thing I do notice is there's definitely a vignette on that. So I would go to here, I create a new item, create a new adjustment layer. I would drop that above. On that adjustment layer, I'd then go to effect controls and add a mask. Then feather that mask off nice and big. We'll change the size of the mask in a minute. Invert the mask and then just start bringing it down using the shadow control like so. Let me just tweak this a bit more. Good idea is to jump out to 25% so you can bring it outside the window if you need to. Yeah, it's there or thereabouts, you know. If I was doing this for real, I might tinker around with it more and more till I get it exactly how I want it, but you get the idea, you know. This is not rocket science stuff that I'm doing to my images here. This is really basic stuff. One of the things I always do is add film stock. I've got a couple of film stocks here in my library of stuff. Let's use a 16mm stock so it's even dirtier. So I put that on top of there, change that to overlay. Yeah, that's more grimy, I like that. What you could do is drop the opacity of it if it's too much, drop it down to 80, but I actually like it as it is. We'll leave it on 100. There. And then that's the one I've just graded now. There is a slight difference actually. This looks a little bit bluer, doesn't it? Yeah. The easiest way would be to go up here and then just cool it off. You know, I'm never going to get it exactly the same as I did it originally, because I have no idea what I did. I can't quite remember. But yeah, it's close, you know. So once I've got one frame, and I generally choose like a hero, what I call a hero frame, like a frame I really like. Once I've got that done, then I will just basically copy that grade over. So we'll copy that grade there, jump onto this frame, paste that grade, make sure you only got Lumetri selected and not the rest of it. And instantly, I mean, I love it. But one of the key things here is that you sharpening the image, so to bring in some detail, but then when you lay the film grain over the top, and once you add that on top over the sharpening, that's what I find gives you the source for me anyway, because you've got a nice sharp image, but then the grain over the top softens it all off and just gives this texture. And I'm all about texture. That's what I'm looking for in my images. I'm generally keeping an eye on my black point, but as important is the white point. I generally want the white point to be lower down than you would think, really. And it wants to be the same in every shot. So here, the white point is just over 90. So let's say if we brought that white point down to 90, then on the next frame, I will want it to be the same. So I would grab my white point here and I would bring that down to 90 there. And then the brightest point in the image is always 90 IRE. I want to keep my white point and my black point exactly the same in every shot. It's a good rule of thumb. There's a slight difference in his face there where I could tinker around with, but I'm not going to do it in this tutorial. I noticed when I flick from there to there. But what you've got to remember is he's in a completely different location in this shot than he is in that shot. And the lighting's different, so you don't want to try and match it bang on. In an edit, a full edit, no one's ever going to notice it. That it's slightly different, that the lighting's slightly different, etc, etc. When you pull out to a wide and then go into a close-up, it's always going to look different, so you don't need to worry about that stuff. So anyway, we'll leave it there.
Alright, thanks for watching this video. If you watched the video, I have made a video for ages. To be honest, I've lost kind of the mojo for filmmaking recently. Just haven't really been focusing on filmmaking, been focusing on climbing. You can see my climbing stuff in the background there. Big into that, been to the Alps. Loved it, absolutely amazing. If you want to check out my climbing videos, I'll stick a link on the screen to that. I'm pretty sure I'll jump back and jump on a film project very soon because I am starting to get the itch for it. So anyway, thanks for checking out the video. See you soon.